Welcome to MOOC lectures on strategy and introduction to game theory. In this module, we are going to discuss a solution concept named subgame perfect equilibrium. By the way, why do we need a new solution concept? Let us go back to the technique that we learned to solve an extensive form game. The name of the technique was backward induction. So, just to recap, let us see how do we do. We start towards the end and we go back towards the beginning. So, what happens if player 1 given a chance, player 1 would play. If player 1 moves in this direction, if player 1 moves in this direction, player 1 gets 1. If player 1 moves in this direction, he gets 0. Notice here there is no strategic interaction. As soon as the player 1 decides, the game ends. So, he does not have to worry about anything. So, of course, what should he do? He is a rational player. He is interested in maximizing his payoff. He does not care about the payoff that player 2 receives. If he cares, then we have to build it in the model. But once we have written the payoff, then what he cares about is maximizing his payoff. He does not care about the payoff of other player. So, as 1 is greater than 0, he will move in this direction, not in this direction. So, game will proceed here. Now, player 2, at this point, if player 2 gets a chance to play, player 2 knows that player 1 is rational and he will move in this direction. So, if player 1 decides to move in this direction, game will reach here and player 2 will get 0. But if player 2 decides to move in this direction, player 2 will get 2. Of course, 2 is greater than 0. So, game will proceed in this direction. As player 2 is not only rational, player 2 knows player 1 is rational. So, game will not proceed in this direction. Similarly, here we can see player 2 has to decide between two actions. One action is to move in this direction, another is to move in this direction. Moving in this direction gives player 2 4, moving in this direction gives player 2 3. Of course, 4 is greater than 3. So, game will proceed in this direction, not in this direction. Coming back to here, why can we go back? Because not only player 1 is rational, player 1 knows that player 2 is rational. Player 2 is rational and player 2 knows player 1 is rational and so on. So, it is the implication of common knowledge. So, player 1 sees that if he moves in this direction, game will eventually reach to this point and his payoff will be 2. And if he proceeds in this direction, game will reach here and his payoff would be 3. So, of course, 3 is greater than 2. So, game will proceed in this direction, not in this direction. So, we know the outcome. Let us say that if we name this A and B and then here C, then we can say that right in the beginning, player 1 will take action B and player 2 will take action C. But if you want to describe the strategy that player 1 will take right in the beginning, we cannot simply say B, because B is not his strategy. Player 1 gets to play game at two nodes, one here and another time here. So, his strategy should describe his action at both of these decision nodes. So, what should he do? He should decides to play B here and let us give them name X and Y. And of course, he should decides to play X here. So, X strategy for player 1 is that he should play B X. How about player 2? Similarly, we have to see that player 2 decides to move here and at this node here. So, his strategy should give this particular action here and this particular action here. Okay? And that is how we get the equilibrium. But let us look at a particular limitation of this backward induction technique. And in this, again there is no strategic interaction. Player 2 either has to decide to play X or to play Y. Playing Y gives him higher, so of course, game will move in this direction. But at this point also, player 1 has two action A and B. Which action should he take? Taking action A means that player 2 will get 1, and taking action B means he would get 1. Of course, if player 2 takes action A here and game has reached to this point, the payoff for player 1 would be 4, and if player 2 takes action B, payoff for player 2 would be 0. But notice that here player 2 doesn't care about how much player 1 is getting. Player 2 is interested in only maximizing his payoff. So, but he is indifferent, he can go in this direction, he can go in this direction. Then how should we, what should we do here, what should we take? If we think player 2 is going to take action A, then let us say if we have action P for player 1 and Q for player 1, of course, if player 1 thinks that player 2 is going to play A, then he is better off playing Q, because 4 is greater than 3 or 2. But if player 1 thinks that player 2 is going to play B, then he is better off by playing P. So, how should here backward induction fails? It doesn't give us any answer. And we will see, because we have we may have multiple equilibrium in this game, so that is the reasoning. Again, coming back to the another limitation of backward induction, again let us say player 2 has two action X and Y. Okay? If player 2 takes action X, player 2 gets 2. If player 2 takes action Y, player 2 gets 3. Player 2 should take action Y. So, for all practical purposes, we can delete this part, because player 1 knows that player 2 is rational. So, if game reaches to this point, player 2 is going to play Y. How about here? Can we say player 2 is going to, let us say this is A and this is B, and then if this is the case, we have to have A and B present here. We cannot have different actions at the different nodes of the same information set. Again, you will have to refer, if you are having difficulty in understanding this, then you should look at a module called strategies. Okay? So, player 2, can we say that player 2 decides to take this action A? We don't know. Let me tell you that, let me change this this payoff slightly, then it would become more interesting. Let us make it 2. Okay? So, we cannot say that player 2 will take action A or action B, because player 2 doesn't know whether he game has reached to this node or this node. If he thinks this node has reached, he is better off by taking action A, because 1 is greater than 0. If he thinks this node has reached, then he is better off by taking action B. But the problem is, here game is of imperfect information. Okay? Game is of imperfect information. So, we cannot, the player 2 doesn't know where the game has reached. So, we cannot decide, we cannot reduce, we cannot take out one of the branches and say this is what player 2 would do. So, backward induction would not work here. We should also, but you may say that why are you talking about a new solution concept, as we already have a solution concept known as Nash equilibrium. So, for that I want to remind you that this was the entry game that we discussed earlier. What did we see? That if we use backward induction, fortunately backward induction works here, and what did we see? That entrant enters, here we have entrant, and incumbent accommodates. This is the outcome we get. But when we use the solution concept of Nash equilibrium, we get two different possibilities. E and A is of course one of the possibilities, but we also get O comma F as another possibility. This is really absurd, because it doesn't satisfy sequential rationality, because game is of common knowledge. Entrant would know if game reaches to this point, player 2 has no option but to accommodate. So, saying O comma F, it may be rational at this point, but it is not rational when game reaches to this point. So, in that sense, O comma F is an absurd outcome recommended by Nash equilibrium. Can we have a technique to get rid of this absurd outcome? Of course, we have, that is backward induction, but we saw that backward induction doesn't work in some of the cases. So what do we really need? Backward induction is a good concept for extensive form game, but we need some modification in backward induction to obtain solutions in all of the extensive form games. So let us define something called subgame. What do we mean by a subgame? Again, let us go back before I define subgame. Let us look at this entry game, because game is moving in linear fashion. First entrant gets to decide whether to enter or remain out of the game, and then incumbents get to decide. When at look at the game at this point, one can say that a new game is beginning here. Whatever happened in the past, that incumbent takes as given, and now he doesn't need to consider what has happened in this part. Only he needs to consider what is going to happen from now onwards. So that's how we get the concept of subgame. We can say this is the new game which is beginning at this point when this node has reached, and this is a subgame. So every moment, you know, as we are moving in the game, we have to consider the past, but only in the sense that we have to take it as given. If game has reached to this particular node, then nothing can be done for the past nodes. That can only be taken as given. So that's why we define subgame. So what do we have as subgame? What we say that subgame begins at some decision node. Say A, I'm just saying one of the, I'm giving that name A, with a singleton information set. So very, very clear, a subgame begins at the singleton information set. Why not an information set which has more than one element? Let us look at it. Here, a subgame cannot begin at this information set. Why? Because player, let's say here we have player 1, here we have player 2. Player 2 doesn't know whether this has reached or this has reached. So he doesn't have a clear cut picture from the past, so that we cannot say a game begins here. But in case we have situation like this, where player 2 here has clarity that this node has reached, if it has reached, then he doesn't need to consider what's happening here. Or what's happening here, he will consider a new beginning of a new game from this onward. So that's what I am saying, that subgame begins only at the information sets which are singleton. Second requirement is that it includes all the successor node. Again, it would be, let us take another example. This is the case. Here we have player 1, here we have player 2, here we have player 3. Okay? What we are saying, that if we say that subgame is beginning here, then all the successor nodes should belong to this subgame. Why? Because notice we are deciding now, game is at this stage. So we don't know whether game will proceed in this direction or in this direction or in this direction. So we cannot consider, let's say, this, 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 and not this. Okay? So what we say, that once a node is included in the subgame, all the successor node of this node would be included in the subgame. And I have already said, I just want to emphasize that if it includes one node from the information set, then it includes all the nodes of that information set. Notice that whole game is also a subgame of itself, because whole game would satisfy all the criteria. So we define again for the sake that we have something called proper subgame. It is the part of the game tree whose root is, sorry, I think I have written it incorrectly here. Proper subgame is all the subgame of the game excluding the whole game itself. And of course, here everything is that we have notion of movement. If game is moving in this direction, it should be clear. Okay. So, for example, how many sub-games do we have in this game? One, of course, beginning right at the initial node, because whole game is sub-game of itself. All the whole game is not proper sub-game of itself, but it is a sub-game of itself. Another is beginning here. So, we can say if we start drawing, this is one sub-game, this is another sub-game, this is another sub-game, and then the whole game is sub-game of itself. So, how many we get? 1, 2, 3, 4. This game has 4 sub-games, 3 proper sub-games. Okay. Here, another example, how many sub-games do we have in this game? You should pause and think before you say. I suggest that you write it in your notebook that how many sub-games do we have in this game. Of course, one sub-game is starting here. And another, the whole game is also sub-game of itself. But can we say a sub-game is starting here? No, we can't say. Why? Because the third criteria says that if a node is included in the sub-game, the node belonging to information, all the nodes belonging to those information set present in this sub-game should also be in this sub-game. For example, let me say it again that if, let us say, this node is present in the sub-game, this node also belongs to the same information set, to the information set that this node belongs to. But if we say this is a sub-game, we are excluding this. So, this cannot be a sub-game. In fact, this game has only 2 sub-games. So, that's it about the sub-game. Now, we are going to learn the solution concepts.